This is the sixth Geopolymer Camp. It is now a tradition that I present the state of the geopolymer research and development every year. It is a summary of what we consider as being very important since the last Geopolymer Camp. All the Geopolymer Camps are recorded on videos, and we have started in 2009, 2010, 11, 12, 13. The videos are available on our internet pages dedicated to each Geopolymer Camp. It lasts around circa 1 hour. And it is also available as a bonus in the USB stick that is with the tutorial Geopolymer for Newcomers. It usually comprises four parts: Geopolymer Science, Geopolymer Technologies, Geopolymer Cement and Concrete, Geopolymer and Archaeology. Today, for this year, I will only concentrate on Geopolymer Science and Geopolymer Cement, because we are witnessing very important breakthroughs. So, let's start with Geopolymer Science. It is always interesting to see how it was at the beginning. This is 1988, our first conference. The comparison of what we have today. These are the various research laboratories in the world working on the subject. And it is obvious that the increase in laboratory has a strong input on the number of scientific papers that are published each year. This is the graph that shows the evolution. We have the years here, and here the number of papers published. Selected scientific papers published per year, peer-reviewed with the keyword geopolymer, when you type it in the database. Started 1991, this is my first paper officially recognized as the starting of geopolymer science. We started 10 years earlier, or 15 years earlier, and you see that for numbers of years, the publications, the making of papers was not very efficient, since in fact we were not a lot of laboratories working on the subject. And then it started to increase and increase. Here in 2011, we had 150 papers per year. 2012, 220, 240, and 2013, more than 400. So facing this exponential increase of scientific paper, I started to wonder whether it should be relevant that we get our own Journal of Geopolymer Science. I will have a special topic on that subject after the coffee break. Or if we have to keep it as it is. Another improvement in teaching and communication in geopolymer science is provided by our webinar series that I started in 2013 in spring, and then in fall, that will be, we had it in spring 2014, and I guess it will be repeated. This is the basics of geopolymer science. It lasts 3 hours on online with sessions and question and answers. And our spring for this year, we had 210 registered participants. Two sessions per day, so there are 2 days, two sessions per day. The first day in the morning for the Eastern Hemisphere, and in the afternoon for the Western Hemisphere. The first day, talk number one, comprises applications and commercializations. What is a geopolymer? The six basic rules in geopolymer processing, geopolymer science and pyramids. The second day, talk number two, principles of aluminosilicate geopolymer science, heat and fire resistant geopolymer, fly ash based geopolymer, durability tests, geopolymer standards, low CO2, and geopolymer science and Roman cement. We have all these parts on the internet at our webinar page. Number one, application and commercialization. It's last 15 minutes. What is a geopolymer? The six basic rules. Last 33 minutes. We will have it tomorrow at the beginning of the cement session. Geopolymer science and pyramids, principles and so forth, fly ash based, durability test, geopolymer cement, geopolymer science and Roman cement. And this is as a bonus in the USB stick also, geopolymer for newcomers. In 2008, I presented the roadmap for research and development at the Second International Congress on Ceramics that we had in Verona. And it comprised 15 research topics. And we see what had been done since 2008. We have a lot of results, and I will present them. Polymeric character of geopolymers, polysiloxonate soluble silicate, these are the water glass knowledge, metakaolin based, calcium based geopolymer, rock based geopolymer, silicate based geopolymer, fly ash based geopolymer, phosphate based geopolymer, organomineral geopolymer, long term durability, geopolymer fiber composites, geopolymer and ceramic processing, the manufacture of geopolymer cement, geopolymer concrete, and materials for medicinal applications. Let's start with the first topic, polymeric character of the geopolymers. We are dealing with knowledge on the minute macromolecular structure of what has been synthesized, and also the introduction of the sol gel technique. I will talk about the sol gel technique later in my talk. This is a webinar talk on what is a geopolymer. Second topic, polysiloxonate. These are dealing with the soluble silicate, water glass. We are witnessing the following. Water glass is one of the basic elements of synthesis of aluminosilicate geopolymers. And there is now more and more laboratories and the companies that are no longer purchasing their water glass, their sodium or potassium silicates from the industry, but manufacturing them themselves, starting from microsilicate or silica fume. So it is important to see or to study the differences between the two systems. One, the industrial one, is usually based on the smelting of quartz at high temperature, whereas the second one is practically at room temperature or at a very low temperature. So the results should be different, and they are. So this study was based on the making of a water glass solution starting with microsilicate, and some definitions in order to understand what is going on in the system. On the silicon speciations, we have to learn the following. We have several units that will then build the molecules in solutions and will be the first steps of geopolymerization. What we see, Q0, means that this silicon unit, SiO, is alone. It is a monomer, it is a monosilicate. Q1 Q1 means that it has one covalently bonded SiO unit, only one, and it is a dimer. So this is at the beginning a little confusing. It is Q1, but it is a dimer with two Si. Q2 means that this silicon is has two covalently bonded SiO unit. Q3, this silicon has three SiO unit covalently bonded to him. This is a branched molecule. And this one, SiQ4, means a three-dimensional system with four SiO units. And you can imagine that when you start with this one and end up increased, the dimensions of your molecules are increasing tremendously. So this is what we see now. So the problem is we will compare what we have when we make our sodium silicate solution with silicafume, for example, or melted quartz, that's the traditional way. And I have plotted here the molar ratio, the influence of alkalination of the solution. So because this represents here, for example, 328, this is the regular water glass that you get from the industry with a modulus ratio 3.2, and we increase the alkalinity of the system. So you see here the Q4, Q3, Q2, Q1, Q0, we come later more precisely on it. What is important, that this is the starting element, generally. We add alkali, so the molar ratio, that is SiO2, Na2O, diminish from 2. Here we have a ratio 1.33, that is around practically the ratio that is used in the majority of geopolymer medium. It's 1.3, 1.4, 1.5, and 1.0. This is something that I don't recommend to be used every day. It is strongly alkaline, but it is used for special applications. So what is important is to see these structures. So you will see the increase of dimensions. Q0, monosilicate. Q1, and here we introduce the Q2 SiO2 unit. So we have one molecule, one SiO2, that has two covalent bonded Si, 1, 1. Here we have an SiQ1, and this is a molecule. It could be longer, with only SiQ2, Q2, Q2, Q2. This is a linear chain. Then, in fact, this is an exception. Normally, in concentrated solution, we will get cycles. The cycle with Q2, Q2 cycle, this one, Q2 also, you see, 1Q2, 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 1Q2. This is a tetramer, tetrasilicate. And then it becomes more complicated with Q3. So we have 1Q1, this is an end group, and we have tetramer here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is an hexasilicate. And the dimension of this unit is still bigger than this one, even if we are still in the same water glass solution. And we introduce other structures that are in solution. Q3, we have here Q2. Q2, these are the and branch, and then here Q3, and this one, Q2, Q3, Q3, Q3. So you see the differences between this one, that is more reactive than this one's, because these ones, in order to react with all the system, it has to be degraded, depolymerized. And if there is not enough alkali, it will be, it remains in this with this dimension, but it is not very important, since what is important is what we have as a result of the geopolymerization. But it is important to know what is really happening with the silicate solution, that we are manufacturing, because it continues. Q3, here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is hexamer, and the same hexamer, this is a cube. And here we have a dodecamer. These are real molecules that we have in the solution with a low alkali concentration. And this is here the quartz molecule that is always in a water glass, what you get from the industry, the Q4 system. So if we come back to the graph that shows the evolution, so you see that at the beginning, you have Q4, three-dimensional, a lot of Q3, branched, the big molecules, no Q0 at all, no small molecules, very few Q1, and very few Q2. And one increases the alkalination, one has the Q4 disappears, and we have an increase in Q0 and Q1. That is, with alkalination, we are degrading, depolymerizing the big molecules and starting to produce smaller ones that are more reactive. You see the difference. You see the differences and the problems that could be between quartz-based or macrosilica-based. More branch molecules for macrosilica-based than for quartz. More Q2 from quartz than from silicate. But essentially, we have at the end here, when it is we have more alkali, we have for silicate always more Q0, more small molecules, more Q1 than from quartz. Which means for me that the systems are different. And the problem is that it's fine if it is different. The problem is that it remains always with the same constitution. This is what chemical industry with their silicate was never capable of doing it. When you receive your water glasses from the supplier, you don't know exactly what you have in it. You have degrébomé, the viscosity, they add more or less water in it to reach it, but be sure that from one production to the other, the concentration in the various elements are different. And this must be then adapted by exactly always doing the same recipe in order to get the same concentrations and essentially the same processing. And there is a time of maturation, and we in our labs and we in our partner companies, we ask that all the solutions are prepared in advance and can be used 6 months long when they are stabilized. This warranty quality, and this will warranty quality in the production of the product that are manufactured. Continue, 15 research topic. 3, metakaolin. Metakaolin, we have now, you know, metakaolin is made by the calcination of kaolinitic clay. We have the synthesis of metakaolin. Start with the sol gel method. We first make the kaolinite by sol gel and then calcine it at 750 degrees C. I talk it about later. Calcium-based geopolymer. Here we will see the tremendous difference between alkalination, alkali activation, and geopolymerization. And I take the example of the slag. Alkali activated slag versus slag-based geopolymer cement. To start, one must know what we have in the slag. The slag is made out of a glassy substance that is called the melilite, which is a solid solution of galenite. This is a silico-aluminate of calcium and acuminate magnesium silicate and of calcium too. And these two minerals are subjective to alkalination and depolymerized. Under the action of the alkali, the galenite is transformed into an orthosilate hydrate, a small molecule, and precipitation of aluminum. There is here one aluminum and here the second, because here in the structure we had two for one SI. One Al, one Al, one SI, two Al, two one SI. Acuminate under the alkali is depolymerized into a small molecule, a disilicate, calcium disilicate hydrate, that is the CSH of the cement chemistry, and precipitation of magnesium hydroxide. So, what is happening under alkalination? We have here the two molecules that will interact and form a more complicated system, SI, 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 3SI with 1Al, with the Q2 units, and the calcium, this is the CSH, some of the CSH remains, and we have precipitation of aluminum hydroxide, magnesium hydroxide, and calcium hydroxide. The problem. This is what we have. The aluminum is outside. The aluminum is outside of the structure. Not the aluminum, the potassium, the alkali. The aluminum is here and the alkali is outside. Which means that this structure, if it stays as it is dangerous in terms of physicochemical properties. The potassium, the alkali, or the sodium will migrate very fast in contact with water. We will get a lot of leachates. We get a lot of bad properties. But this is the this is alkali activated slag. The presence of this free alkali is always here. This is not geopolymer. This is not geopolymer made out of slag. Since geopolymerization must provide a stable material, it must provide a material that will withstand all corrosions, because this is the chemistry that we have invented and that we are developing. So all people who are claiming that alkali activation of slag is similar to geopolymerization are totally wrong. And essentially in a lot of scientific papers that are dealing with the system, and because they are only doing this first step of geopolymerization, this is alkali activation, they end up with bad results in their studies. So we have to continue geopolymerization. This is not finished. From alkali activation to geopolymer cement, we must add a networking element that will interact with this potassium aluminium that is free. And here, nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, silicon, alkali activated slag, it is here. We have SiQ2, dangerous. We add 20 parts of metakaolin, and we end up with SiQ3, that is a branched molecule that is still bigger and more stable. And we had 30 parts of metakaolin, and we end up with SiQ4, stable system, three-dimensional networking. If we look at what is happening on the structures themselves, so we start here. This is slag alkaline activation. We add metakaolin. We have a solid solution of two systems, calcium polysilate, SiL1, sodium polysilate disiloxo, SiL3, and they interpolycondense into a three-dimensional network. The problem, this guy provides higher strength. So all the people are just looking at the strength. You get 90 MPa when you just alkali activate slags. I say, wow, wonderful. Here, with a genuine metacaolin-based geopolymer, you only get 60. Bad. Well, in fact, you can also achieve 150 afterwards. But at the beginning, here, and this is why they claim that alkali activation is better. In terms of strength, yes. In terms of long durability, no. You'll get all kinds of leachates. All the studies that are done and shows bad leachates and bad value for geopolymers are based on these chemical reaction. We come back later. I have a beautiful study at the end of my keynote on that subject. So this is the result of so the difference between alkaline activation, and this is why I'm against the alkaline activation, and also the terminology that is associated with it. This is banished from all our papers. And if by chance we start the Journal of Geopolymer Science, there will be no mention at all of alkaline activation. They will be rejected. Continue. Rock-based geopolymer, so this is the introduction of a new species. This is the ferrosilate, F-A-O-S-I. The iron is taking the place of the aluminum. Silica-based geopolymer, the nanopolysilanol, the SiO. This provides very interesting products, like this one. So you see here we have our nanosilicates, and in between our geopolymer polysilanol chain, and you recognize this structure that we also had at the beginning. But it is here, and it provides good properties to the material. Fly ash-based geopolymer, no improvement, besides the fact that I am strongly propagating not to use the alkali-activated fly ash system. Phosphate-based geopolymer, I hope we have the presentation this afternoon. Usually we should have one. So far, I guess she's not here. Organic mineral geopolymer, these are the preparation of hybrids between minerals and organics. This is where a lot of industries are working in order to make paints, coatings, adhesives, and so forth, by introducing several organic groups. And in fact, one has to study the compatibility rules between the two systems. Usually they are not compatible. And the team at Napoli Partenope University has found some rules that have been presented last year at the keynote. So you will find the presentation and the keynote 2013, a special presentation by Dr. Giuseppina Roviello. This is a mixture of epoxy resin and metacaolin-based polysilate siloxo. I read just a small summary. A good compatibility between the organic and the aqueous inorganic phases is obtained thanks to the numerous hydroxyl tails, OH, that are formed during the epoxy ring opening reaction that makes the organic phase temporarily hydrophilic. This is the problem. We must have two hydrophilic systems in order to interact properly, increasing the compatibility with the aqueous inorganic phase. This is what we have in our geopolymerization, condensation of the units. This is sodium oligosilate, and here we have one, two, three that are polycondensing to provide this unit. You see the OH group. The epoxy group, we have the epoxy group that has its opening COH, and that is compatible with the system. So So for details, go to the keynote by Dr. Roviello in 2013. Long-term durability. For the first time, we have an official link between geopolymer science and Roman cement. Before that, I was claiming that some of the Roman cements were similar to geopolymer cement. They say, no, this is CSH-based, this is regular lime-based cement. And we have the silent link that has been discovered. We show you, talk about it this afternoon at the beginning of the session on ancient technology. And this is, in fact, the part number 10 of my webinar. Geopolymer fiber composite. High temperature up to 1300 degrees C by using flax fibers. Geopolymer in ceramic processing, there are groups that are trying to get ceramics by introducing cesium, lithium, gallium, and germanium. The synthesis are difficult, so they are obtaining something, but so far it is only in the lab. Manufacture of geopolymer cement. This is the new raw material for the ferro-silicate base. Geopolymer concrete, and this is one of my major topic of this keynote. And material for medicinal applications. So usually I have geopolymer technologies. Today I don't have any. But I will just briefly mention what I showed you yesterday from the webinar, that is the fact that the geopolymer science is creating jobs, and this is very important. This is how it should be. I mentioned the fact that the Banner UK is now starting very soon the production, and we will have tomorrow a talk by Andrew McIntosh on the subject. Job opportunities, January, February, March, we had several jobs offered and covered. TU Delft, long performance geopolymer cement, geopolymer research at University of Oulu, these are jobs. University of Swinburne, University Technology Sarawak Campus in Malaysia, and the one at Wagner's that they are implementing very rapidly in Australia. So, you come to the main topic of my keynote, geopolymer cement and concrete. Usually, the geopolymer cement and concrete is only one-fourth of my keynotes. Here it is practically half. But before that, I want to introduce recent news from the Nuclear Decommissioning Authority, June 2014. Innovation investment bears fruit. Ceramic technologies could polish up sites. A unique technology has been developed that could help to treat radioactive waste at lower cost and more effectively in the future. The approach being pioneered by Lucidium, formerly Ceram, a materials consultancy company whose expertise emerged from the ceramic industry in Stoke-on-Trent. We had the geopolymer conference specially for the people that are part of the Ceram group in Stoke-on-Trent on December 2012. And so this ceramic system involves pouring a slurry of mineral-like minerals or geopolymer onto the waste, which hardens the material into a resilient solid. I will provide more detail this afternoon when we talk about waste, radioactive waste. But the conclusions are important. The study exceeded our expectation, and the experimentation results provided advantages we had not foreseen. The nature of geopolymer means the encapsulant produced can be pumped into the skips either from the top on the, or the bottom, whilst still permeating the entire waste volume and successfully immobilizing it. Now, we have a news from the US. We are in the grout and mortars, so we are slightly coming to concrete. And this is by Milliken. The company is a big chemical company that purchased a startup geopolymer company in the US that had been starting with what they call the geospray. And I have a small video. So, we stay in the U.S., and we had this news last year in Los Angeles Times. This is the North Carolina University that was involved in a solar decathlon, purpose to build houses only where the energy was only coming from the sun. And the journalist wrote the following: "It's my understanding your house uses a geopolymer cement concrete that reduces the carbon footprint." And this is what they made at University of North Carolina, Charlotte. They had within the walls their cooling pipes, and it is fly ash based geopolymer cement and concrete. However, the most important breakthrough came from totally different countries, from Australia, not from Melbourne, not from Perth, but from Brisbane. We have there entrepreneurs that have been strongly involved in the development of geopolymer concrete since 2009. University of Queensland Global Change Institute Zero Energy and Carbon Neutral Workplace, the University of Queensland Global Change Institute, designed by Hassel in conjunction with Bleak, Tyners and Wagners, is the world's first building to successfully use geopolymer concrete for structural purpose. What we have here are the three floors made of precast geopolymer concrete. You have the floors, one, two, and three. And inside, on the ceilings of the floors, they have their cooling pipes. So it is Brisbane, it is hot there, humid and hot, and their major concern is the cooling and not the heating. This is how it looks like now inside. The slabs are not covered with any paint, so they are naturally beautiful white. And this is these are the slabs, 10.5 meters long, that are put in place. Three floors, 33 precast panels of slag, fly ash based geopolymer concrete. It has been made by the companies called Wagners, and they coined their product earth-friendly concrete. And first, their first beam that they manufactured was used for testing. And this is the beam that has been tested for elastic deflection under the load, 10.5 meters long. And this is the result. No fatigue at all. They are using the geopolymer concrete to make vaults for tunnels. Why? Because the geopolymer concrete or geopolymer cement has two very important properties. First, it is fire resistant. It does not explode like Portland cement. It is a very important material in terms of fire resistant concrete. And second, because of the chemical resistance, corrosion to any salt and so forth. And especially in the Middle East, the fact that everything is corroding there is very important for them. And since it is pretty, it is used as for urban design. But the implementation is becoming bigger and bigger. They are now involved in the entire airport, regional airport in Brisbane. The second airport is practically finished. They have made with geopolymer concrete the entire buildings, the tarmac, and so forth. And the inauguration will take place this fall, 2014. You see them working on the airport site. They have the concrete batch plant. The geopolymer concrete can be delivered by truck, pump or chute. They were using the chute system. Their machinery equipment was not ready for regular application as Portland on the as on the ways, but this is how they made their major pavement. So, seeing that is evolving at a tremendous pace, the question is, why did it take so long to reach this important commercialization? So we had a lot of pilot projects, but no real commercialization. This is one. 1983, this is the first invention of slag-based metakaolin cement. When I was at the central laboratory in Houston at Lone Star Industries in 1983, we and the team there, we invented the slag metakaolin Geopolymer. So it is 30 years later that the system, based on the alkalination of slag, comes to real practice. Why did it take so long? I presented my first answer last year in the review that is available on the library. This is paper number 21. And I will read some of the text I put there. The existing Portland cement standards are not adapted to geopolymer cement. They must be created by an ad hoc committee, yet to do so requires also the presence of standard geopolymer cement. Presently, every expert is providing his own recipe based on local raw materials, waste, byproduct, or extracted. There is a need for selecting the right geopolymer cement category. The 2012 State of the Geopolymer Research and Development suggested to select two categories, namely, one, slag fly ash based geopolymer cement, because fly ashes are available in the major emerging countries. Second, ferrosilicate based geopolymer cement, similar to rock-based, this geological iron-rich raw material is present in all countries throughout the world. I present now the excerpt of my keynote 2012 on that subject. This is a 10-minute long video. So when I started and when I developed the geopolymer, some of the geopolymer cement, I was proud to answer to the question, well, how do we be sure that we will produce geopolymer cement everywhere in the world? I said, no problem. We have so many possibilities. There are so many rock-forming materials that will be suitable to make a geopolymer cement. It will be very easy. It is not, because the transfer technology, transfer knowledge is not so easy. You have a couple of people, like myself and others, that have the knowledge, and that's all. So it is too complicated, which means, in order to cope with the issue, we have to establish standards for the global economy. In my book, we have, for example, for cement, a list of several raw materials. Everybody is proud to publish. I made geopolymer cement with this type of waste or with this type of material and so forth. This is not the way to promote the system if we want to save the world. If we don't want, it's okay. So establish standards for global economy, and I'm proposing, from my point of view, we should have maximum two universal and user-friendly geopolymer process. The first one, based on fly ash. I explain later. The second one, based on ferrosilicate. And of course, we need an industrial hardener based on geology. So you see, we have one, another industrial waste, fly ash. Second, geology. The first criteria is user-friendly. So let us come back to the standards. First, sodium, potassium, calcium-based fly ash-based geopolymer cement. I always was skeptical about fly ash, and I only studied the fly ash in the years 2005, practically 20 years after starting geopolymer cement. We had a European project that I was involved in, and I started to look at. For me, fly ash was not a relevant material in terms of raw material for geopolymer cement. But nevertheless, I published in 1994 in an American scientific magazine, World Resource Review, under the title Global Warming Impacts on the Cement and Aggregate Industries. Third world development means implementing the use of electricity and building infrastructures and houses. In short, electricity and concrete. The byproduct of electricity production with coal firing is fly ash. The innovative step would be to produce electricity and low CO2 cement, geopolymeric cement, in the same plant by adapting and implementing fly ash production into geopolymeric raw material without any supplementary chemical CO2 emission. This is what I envisage. I say, look, this would be a great innovation, provided the power plants, utilities, are also tackling the problem and just changing the way they introduce their coal, the way they burn it, and so forth. I know that it is feasible. But at that time, everybody was telling, well, coal is emitting a lot of CO2, so the use of coal to produce electricity should decline. So I was not interested in working on fly ash. I was wrong. The problem is the following. World energy sources, oil declined, but coal declined at the beginning, but then now it is increasing by 25% within one decade since 2002. And this is the trend will continue. And this is due to the BRICS country, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa. So coal use for producing energy is becoming important, which means fly ash is important. And the majority of studies that are done in India, for example, on geopolymer concrete are based on fly ash. So we have to cope with coal fly ash geopolymerization. But not at 60 degrees C, not at 85 degrees C, and so forth. It must be a cement. For me, a cement is something that hardens at room temperature. Otherwise, it is something different. It is a binder, or it is a resin, but it is not a cement. So any system that is developed that requires temperatures is not. Well, they say it's fine for precast, good, but this is not what we are looking for. We want mass production. Remember, we want to save the world. The majority of those who are studying coal fly ash, so-called geopolymer, are in fact doing alkali activation of the fly ash. And we are comparing now the alkali activation of fly ash with the regular, genuine geopolymer fly ash. The conventional method means alkali activation, which means dissolution of the fly ash. This is the main objective. We have to dissolve the fly ash in order to get the Si and the aluminum cations in the mixture so that they can polycondense and make the geopolymer. So we get zeolite. So we use concentrated caustic soda or very strong sodium silicate solutions with a high degree of alkali in it, curing 80 degrees C. Voila. This is a user hostile system. More than 50 or 60% of all papers dealing with so-called fly ash geopolymer are proposing a user hostile system. And this is wrong. The geopolymeric methods is a room temperature hardening. It involves the polycondensation. We use the fly ash. I prefer potassium silicate solution. We use blast furnace slag as the geopolymeric precursor, water, and it is user-friendly. It is a cement. If we compare the compressive strength with the alkali activated fly ash in light blue and the geopolymer fly ash in dark blue for five different fly ashes, the geopolymer is always higher in strength. Here, these are the 15 fly ashes that of our GeoAsh European programs. We got four that experienced flash set because they were class C, lot of calcium, free calcium in it, and they could not be used in our system. All the others are providing medium to very high strength. Wagner's is using the slag, fly ash based geopolymer cement system, the one that we are recommending, the first category of the system. Slag, fly ash based geopolymer cement. But because there are no dedicated standards to precisely test this type of cement, they decided to create them with the help of a very renowned engineering service multinational company. And I'm presenting the data that have been collected by this service company that will become the basic for the writing of the standards. It has been presented at various conferences in Singapore, in Australia, titled Engineering Properties of a Proprietary Premix Geopolymer Concrete by James M. Aldred, Technical Director of AECOM. This is a well-known multinational engineering service. And this one, what I took on, was presented at the Concrete Conference in Australia at Gold Coast last year. So this is what he wrote. He wrote practically what I was telling you 5 minutes ago. Geopolymer concrete has been extensively studied by various universities and is starting to gain acceptance in a range of different applications. There are many publications discussing different properties or geopolymer synthesized from different raw materials and activators. Product information sheets and even technical papers may present positive data obtained from different binder chemistries, giving the misleading impression that a specific proprietary material has been comprehensively tested when it has not. Alternatively, papers may also focus on a particular material with poor performance to negatively characterize geopolymers. And this is the case for the majority of those dealing with alkali activation, or the alkali activated materials. One common concern raised by designers regarding the use of geopolymer concrete is compliance with the relevant Australian standards. Standards necessarily develop from the established construction materials and practices which can inhibit the use of innovative materials and procedures. Generally, national standards and codes, which are more prescriptive in nature and explicitly limit concrete to a Portland cement-based binder, are an impediment to non-Portland-based binders being accepted in the industry. For those who are not fluent in English, impediment means hindrance or obstruction in doing something. So the present standards are an obstruction and hindrance to introducing geopolymer cement and geopolymer concrete. European Concrete Standard AN206 includes an equivalent performance concept. It is based on performance alone. However, there is a restriction that potential binders should comply with European cement standard EN197, and therefore would technically exclude geopolymers which do not contain Portland cement clinker. By chance, this is a chance that the Australians have, Australian standard for concrete structure, AS3600, is obviously based on Portland cement, concrete. The components of the standard are primarily performance-based. One is tackling the performance and see how the product is behaving. Therefore, it is possible to compare the performance of a specific proprietary geopolymer concrete. So the Australian standard is not specifically requiring that it should be Portland cement. They forgot it. Therefore, it is possible to compare the performance of a specific proprietary geopolymer concrete with the expected performance from a Portland cement-based concrete with regard to the engineering durability and other significant properties listed in the standard. This approach provides an objective basis to assess any concerns with using a non-traditional cement, such as a geopolymer. So, a total quantity, of approximately 5,000 cubic meters geopolymer concrete, that is 12,000 tons, has been poured to date. This has been written in October 2013. It is certainly not lab-crete. Much of the data presented in this paper is taken from the grade 40 geopolymer, that is 40 MPa, geopolymer production concrete, used in the precast floor panels for the Global Change Institute, the one that I showed you previously, the project at University of Queensland that has been cast from April to October 2012. So, let's see the properties. So, they have been comparing the properties of EFC, geopolymer concrete, with Portland cement in the Australian standard. Compressive strength equivalent. Well, this is obvious that the compressive strength is equivalent, since the compressive strength is strongly dependent on the aggregates, not on the binder. If you have a poor aggregate, you get a poor strength. Even if your binder is super strong, this is the aggregate that is the weak point. On the opposite, flexural strength, 30% higher. We in the lab experienced up to 100% higher. Early age strength, good. Shrinkage, lower, average. So these are results from production, regular production, not from just a small pilot in the lab. Acid resistance, this is one of the properties of geopolymer cement, very high. Sulfate resistant, very high. They just write higher, but it's for me very high. Chloride resistant, very high. Heat of reaction, very low. And fire resistance, very high. They started the development of geopolymer concrete because of the environmental issue, CO2 emission. And this is how they were involved in the manufacture of these floors, of these slabs, for the Global Change Institute in Brisbane. And by doing this, they discovered that, in fact, the geopolymer concrete has such good properties that what they are now witnessing is that their sell and marketing arguments are, well, of course, environmental CO2 reduction, but more than this, their intrinsic chemical resistance property with regard to Portland cement, because for them this is where the market is. This is where they want to really develop their production worldwide, essentially in the Middle East. So let's come back to the heat of reaction. We have here They made a comparison, one cubic meter block of a mixture of OPC and slag. This is a mix that generates low heat generally, and they compared it with the geopolymer concrete. So you see the temperature rise and the time. After 7 hours, the temperature rose to 15 degrees C and then declined. And for the regular Portland, it continued to raise, to rise, and to rise up to 35 degrees C. For people, this is important, those who are involved in mass construction. But now, let's compare one testing that is always discussed in scientific papers, the carbonation test. The carbonation test, it means what happens when the concrete is exposed to the atmosphere, how fast the CO2 will enter into the concrete, and it is measured in millimeter. You'll see here the difference between alkali activation, Portland cement, and geopolymer. We have the result for alkali activated slag. We have the result for slag-based geopolymer cement compared with Portland. This is millimeters depths of carbonation. After 7 days, we are like Portland. Same, these are a tenth of a millimeter, is nothing compared to alkali activation. This is alkali activated slag. Remember the structural element that I discussed previously with the alkali, potassium alkali that is outside of the structure that is capable of migration, and this is the one that is carbonating, and this is something that is bad. And a lot of subject of study made on carbonation, on so-called alkali activation geopolymers, are presenting this bad data. This is wrong. These are the figures of slag-based fly ash geopolymer concrete. The average 1.94, and we, of course, Portland clinker is the best, but now, today, is practically no longer used. They are always a mixture of Portland and the slag, so we compare the carbonation for geopolymer concrete and regular Portland. It is the same magnitude, and alkali activated slag concrete is the worst. So the second material is the potassium, sodium potassium calcium ferrosilicate based geopolymer cement. This is the one that is red in color. The slag fly ash base, when it is done properly with the raw materials, is white, and this one is red. This is something that is also interesting. And this is the one that is will be manufactured by Bayer UK, and we get tomorrow the paper by Andrew McIntosh. This raw material is available worldwide, so this is why I want to introduce it. So we have, usually I have geopolymer and archaeology in my keynote today known. This will be this afternoon, at the end of the afternoon, in the ancient technology segment. We have geopolymer science and Holman cement. This is the end of my state of the geopolymer. Thank you very much.